Good afternoon. First of all, let me, on behalf of the Collections and Education Department at the National World War I Museum at Liberty Memorial, say thank you so much for being here. It is truly our pleasure to see many familiar faces, to place faces with voices and emails that we have been exchanging. For some of us, just a matter of weeks, and for others, years. And for those of you who are new to this museum, it is truly our pleasure to have you here and to be hosting this conversation, the conversations that are taking place in this room, but even more importantly, the conversations that are happening outside, sometimes while you're drinking maybe those specialty cocktails and the beer and the wine, and when you're having the breakfast, those connections. That is what we are excited about here, and we look forward to the international collaborations that will be taking place because of this weekend. We're also very pleased to be able to share with you our collection and the story that we get to tell to hundreds and thousands each year. Earlier today, we had conversations about how do we reach real people, not just academics, but how do we reach the youth? How do we reach, I think someone else called it, Dr. Beaumont called it the bottom up. And I think the three gentlemen who are sitting at our stage right now really have their fingers on that pulse, and they are diligently working towards that. It is my pleasure to introduce, I'll go from the far end over here, Brian Grubbs. He is the project director based at Springfield Greene County Library District. And he is leading Over There, Missouri and the Great War. It's a statewide collaborative effort to place documents, photographs, artifacts, and other media into a single digital archive. Since graduating from the University of Kansas with a master's in museum studies, Grubbs has worked as a curator, archival assistant, and a museum consultant. And he's currently the local history and genealogy department manager at Springfield Greene County Library District. Dr. Matthew Shaw has joined us from the British Library. He is the curator of U.S. collections in the Department of the Americas Collection at the library. His research interests lie particularly in the history of the French Revolution, the history of calendars and timekeeping, and in the social and cultural history of the 18th century Atlantic world. I also think, and this may just be rumor, but a moderator does her homework. I think he also has an interest in cycling and may have perhaps participated in the Summer Olympics. Yes.
Only in the opening ceremony.
You can't moderate a digital commemoration without doing a little bit of Google searching. He served as the editor for the journal Resources for American Studies, has been active with the British Association for American Studies. He's an honorary research fellow at Birkbeck College, University London. And he is here today representing a fantastic collaborative project, I think talking about three of them, for Europeana. And on the far end, we have Dr. Patrick Houlihan from the University of Chicago. His book manuscript entitled Catholicism and the Great War, Religion and Everyday Life in Germany and Austria-Hungary, 1914 to 1922, is under contract with Cambridge University Press. His published and forthcoming work includes articles and reviews in Central European history, First World War studies, and he is currently representing his work with a project that you heard a little bit about earlier today. It is the 1914-1918 International Encyclopedia of the First World War. It is a project out of, and I apologize to the German speakers in the audience, the Freie Universität Berlin, BSB, and DFG. I think that is all of the sponsors on that I'm going to talk about, if that's all right with you. And we'll go ahead and begin our panel on digital commemoration. We will have an opportunity for some Q&A. I would highlight that there is a live mic over there on the right with a stand. So at the end when we have that Q&A discussion time, please feel free to use that, as well as we'll try to have someone who is walking around. Without any further ado, Dr. Matthew Shaw.
Thank you very much. So I'm going to talk about three digital projects, and I suppose I'm really going to be asking the question, what is digital commemoration? And I'll do that by talking through these three projects, and how to make them work, how to make them connect real people, as Laura said. I've come from the British Library. I thought I'd introduce that briefly because we're going to be doing some commemorative activity next year, and we're also a key partner in many of these projects. But the library, of course, underpins research as well. So many other projects, and in fact, some of you I'm pleased to have report have already been there for your research or plan on coming there to do your research. Although we hope increasingly, because of the digital efforts, work we're doing, you'll be able to do it from your desktop here. But it's not just a place of books, it's a place of exhibitions. One on Benjamin Franklin there, one on, this is called Taking Liberties, a history of rights and freedoms in Britain, a sort of a constitutional, if that's the right word, history. And there we have the Bill of Rights. So we will also be doing something in 2014 in the library, a free exhibition on the First World War. And that's be focused on our collection of manuscripts, which includes the drafts of many of Wilfred Owen's poems, many of Sigrid Sassoon's works, as well as printing and official papers, such as General Haig's Back to the Wall speech. So that'll be a place for people to come and see the real objects. This is one of the delights about working in the library. You can see the real objects, but also to showcase the digital projects we'll be doing and maybe engage with people in that way. So that was a little preface. I'm going to talk now about the Europeana and three projects in particular. Europeana, for those who don't know, is funded by the European Union, and its aims are quite laudable and quite vast, really. It plans and aims to make Europe's cultural heritage available freely on the web for all citizens of the UK, but also everyone in the world. And it means to do this by combining the work of institutions across Europe through a single search engine or a unified catalogue. And I'll take you through that a bit later. There's also lots of behind-the-scenes work on metadata standards, on projects and technologies, but I won't talk about that in too much detail now. So the projects I'm going to be talking about are all here. Firstly, there's the European Film Gateway 1914. Then Europeana Collections, 1914 to 1918. And then, finally, Europeana 1914 to 1918. And I apologise for the slightly confused naming of these projects. But it confuses everyone, including those working on them. But they're all unified by one thing, these guiding principles. They aim to be freely available. That's quite crucial. They aim to be cross-searchable. So if you search for the Somme, or Bruges, or Gurkhas, you'll find those results across these collections, and not only across these collections, but across Europe. Common metadata standards inform all our work, and these include things like digitization standards, name authorities, so we know if we're referring to General Foch, how we'd refer to him. And there's also a shared understanding of the audience, which is a bit of a cop-out. It's broad, i.e. everybody who wants to do research, but they're also specialised, and each project has its own focus to some extent, whether on school children or on researchers or on particular specific researchers. Okay, so the first project, the European Film Gateway, and here's a clip from one of the films of the period. And essentially, this is combining the resources of 20 film archives across Europe. 25 partners are involved in it. And the end result, and this is the key thing, is over 600 hours of film, and also supporting documentation, so scripts, reference materials, letters, audience reports, and so on. And the idea is these digitized films, these digitized resources, are available via the European Film Gateway and also on Europeana. It doesn't matter where you search, they should come up. And finally, there's going to be a virtual exhibition, so it can be used in classrooms or people just wanting to find out about film and the history of film and the First World War. It'd be a point of departure. And all being well, here's a little clip from a film. The Airship Destroyer. So there we go, and then here shows the site behind it with some of the metadata attached. And again, these are all freely available under Creative Commons licenses. I hope that was visible from up there. Okay, so that's the first project. Secondly, Europeana 1914 to 1918. And this is one of the two Europeana, more traditional, I suppose, in the sense they're dealing with printed material largely, but also 3D objects. And the best way to describe this project is perhaps comparing it to Antiques Roadshow, which I gather you have here. And the idea is people bring in their things from the attic, and curators, museum experts, and members of the Europeana 1914 to 1918 team, which also includes people from Oxford University IT department who've written the software and have come up with the idea and are continuing to support this project as well, and also hope to roll out a wider project in the future. Tell you about these objects, listen to your stories, and help you to write them down and upload them to our Europeana servers. And these take place at museums around the UK. We've done two, one in Preston, one in Banbury. These are both historic garrison towns, so there's a long tradition of military association. And at both occasions, we've been mobbed. I don't think I've ever worked so hard as I did when we did the one in Preston, and there was just queues of people around the block bringing in material. Lots of letters, lots of things saying, Granddad had this in the attic. He never talked about it, but here are all his letters. And all sorts of interesting things came up. The usual collections of medals and citations, sadly. But also these sort of 3D objects. These are souvenirs that were sold in the Middle East, I think, to British soldiers and show various desert scenes around the edge. And that's the one on your left there. And also things like prisoner of wars, diaries and magazines from working in coal mines in Germany. Someone's diary I remember being quite striking, explaining his travels to France, observing the dogfights in the skies. A whole range of material. So these are all scanned on the day and uploaded using people's own words, and we apply our own Europeana-derived naming authorities and subject indexes as well. And here you can see a little bit of the site, which is arranged in themes, provides a sort of a curated way in. And again, all the material is hosted forever by Europeana and is cross-searchable and is freely available. And the people who donated their items to the collection. Of course, they keep the real objects, but they've donated the digital image. They very kindly have given the copyright away as well, in the sense they're licensing it under a Creative Commons license. Okay, now this is the project I'm going to talk in a bit more detail about. Europeana Collections, 1914 to 1918. And the distinction here is that it is to do with institutions. The first project, Europeana 1914 to 1918, is really about people, and it's about engaging with the enthusiasm of the people and people across Europe. I should have said, actually, I forgot to mention, we've also done collection days, antique roadshow days across Europe, including Serbia and Poland, Ireland, France, Germany, where it was very popular, not least because it uncovered a postcard sent by Adolf Hitler whilst he was on the front line, which sort of caught the imagination of the press, actually, for sort of obvious reasons. But they were very popular in Germany, which is interesting when we think about the last panel, which explained the lack of, or the potential lack of, top-down commemoration of the First World War. And the second thing I should also mention is that anybody around the world can contribute to Europeana collections. The site, Europeana 1914 to 1918 is accessible anywhere in the world. You can digitize your stuff yourself and upload it. It would be ideal if we could roll it out in America as well, or perhaps in partnership with others, or share the software or the technology behind it. And that's something we could perhaps talk about over coffee or whatever. So to go back to Europeana Collections, this is the institutional project, I suppose, bringing together the collections and the resources of major libraries across Europe. And there are just some of the items that are within it. It's a three-year project, and the idea is to have 400,000 items by 2014. The project officer of the whole thing, who's in Berlin, it's being run from Berlin, so again, more German involvement, was very keen for me to say that there are already 100,000 items on Europeana, thanks to this project, which you can look at now. These include newspapers, manuscripts, books, prints, drawings, everything apart from sound and video. The focus of these material things that are being digitized initially was treasures, so things like, from our point of view, Wilfred Owen's manuscripts, Sigrid Sassoon, T. Lawrence. But we were also able to do a very broad range of selection, trench journals, plays from the time, postcards, everything from the high-level command papers down to ephemera sent home or produced on the front, and also was going on behind the scenes at the time, popular songs from the day, and also novels and other materials. Again, it's probably because of this involvement, it's fair to say, I think, that it is notable for its size, its diversity, and its quality. It is arguably the largest digitization project of the First World War anywhere. And although I know Australia has a very important and very large digitization program, particularly of their war records and newspapers. But in terms of reflecting a wide range of nations across Europe and indeed across the world, this is perhaps the most important. And here, I suppose, is the underlying theme of the project. We have a map of Europe in 1914, one of those satirical prints showing the belligerent nations. But superimposed on that are little keys showing the 10 libraries and that are participating in this project. We can see everywhere from Italy, France, Germany, Austria, Belgium, Holland, Denmark, and Serbia, as well as Britain. And rather than risk the Wi-Fi, I've done a quick walkthrough of the site here. So say you're interested in World War I, rather than shoes, you can search. And then here is the search results of Europeana. So some women working at the top there. On the left, you can do a faceted search, so you can sort of narrow it down a bit. But say you're interested in the Gurkhas. Your ancestor was in the Gurkhas, so type that in. Lots of things come up, including a Gurkha red flower. So this is the entire Europeana corpus, everything in all European institutions that we have in there. So I'm narrowing it down to things to do with Brighton, because I know there was some connection to Brighton and the Gurkhas. And we've zoomed in on this photograph here from the Girdwood collection of the British Library. But say you don't speak English very well, you can use the translation tool, and that's translated it into Hindi. It's using quite an advanced Microsoft Translate tool. And here we followed the link and jumped to the British Library site, which has jumped back again, and here we have the actual image stored in the British Library's servers, and we can zoom in and work out, is that look like what I remember great-uncle? This chap, they called him Smiler. That was his nickname. Unfortunately, we don't know his actual name. But he's recuperating in Brighton, the Brighton Hospital at the Royal Pavilion. So that's a quick work-through of how Europeana, or run-through of how Europeana works in practice. It brings together a lot of content, but allows you to sort of focus in on the material. And then once you've found what you want, you jump to the library that looks after it. Oops. So going to some of the issues this raises, obviously to make this work is quite a complicated undertaking, not least working with 12 partners. There's a lot of IT infrastructure behind it, of course. There's the Europeana infrastructure, the search box you saw that enabled you to search for Gurkha and bring up the red Gurkha flower, as well as pictures of Gurkhas and transcripts of memoirs of Gurkhas and so on, and the photograph. And then you have each institution's IT structure, some of which is in place, some of which isn't, and at the British Library we're still tweaking ours to make it appropriate, not least to enable OCR to work. That's really a key feature of all this. We have a lot of textual material, and without optical character recognition, it's very hard to search within this vast corpus. But that's on its way and it's coming, and by the time the project is launched, there should be at least a basic searching method, and that will improve over time. So that's one problem which all technical and digital commemorations have, and perhaps it's something that conferences like this allow us to talk about and discuss and share solutions to. Something else that's come up with various people here is the problem of copyright and the problem of going to a library and asking for a photocopy, and they say, sorry, you can't because of copyright, or you can't access it remotely. This is particularly true in Britain and is true in many European countries. Copyright legislation is very strict, I suppose, for want of a better word. There are also regional peculiarities, such as in Britain at least, and several other European countries, all unpublished manuscripts are in copyright until the end of 2039, whether or not that person died 70 years ago or 1,000 years ago. And as national institutions, we have to respect, and of course we do respect that that law. So we have to seek copyright permission from the estates. We have to find these estates, and this is a time-consuming process, but one which we're committed to undertaking with due diligence. Other things are available under Crown copyright legislation or government legislation, but you have to apply for permission and so on. Printed works similarly often have complicated copyrights attached with them, and then the IT infrastructure has to reflect all of this. I raise this probably because it's probably quite a boring issue and an annoying one as a researcher, but it's something, unfortunately, as libraries, we can't get around, but something we spend a lot of our time working on, so please bear with us as we try and make this stuff available, whilst also, of course, protecting your copyrights of your published materials. And then the second, I suppose, issue, challenge, question is selection. I've sort of puffed up this project as a great resource, and it is bringing and making available these resources from these major national libraries from all sides of the conflict, and of course reflecting the empires of these nations as well. And I've shown you some of our material which relates to Commonwealth troops just then. We have lots of Canadian material as well. But it all comes down to the selection of curators to some extent. We've asked curatorial colleagues to select material they think is important and should be used by researchers and school children, and also perhaps should be preserved. So all sorts of decisions about what goes into this corpus, even though it's very large, it still plays a part. And again, like all historical collections, plays a part in the story of that collection and the use that's made of it. Similarly, the community collections, those Antiques Roadshow projects, rely on perhaps self-selection of the people who bring material in. Maybe they're particularly proud of their involvement, of their family's involvement. Maybe they're particularly interested. Maybe it reflects those with a particularly strong military connection, rather than maybe conscientious objectors or women workers in the factories or other groups in the, from the past. And they have their own way of telling the stories. And those stories, as we heard earlier, are really not their living memory, it's collective memory. It's informed by, well, we've already seen Blackadder. It's informed by the readings of war poets. It's informed by contemporary concerns as well. And those go into the collections. So the collections, to some extent, are also about the memory of the war, as they are of the war itself. Then the thing we're all talking about, I suppose, is dissemination and audience awareness. I've stumbled over the names Europeana, Collections of Europeana, 1914 to 1918. They're not the snappiest of terms. A lot of my library colleagues, unfortunately, don't really know about Europeana, so we know we've got an uphill battle. We are doing things about that. The collection days are one great way of getting the word out. Local news love those sorts of events, indeed national news. So if you have a local institution that wants to host one, it's a very good way to get it on the news. But we're also making Europeana, and indeed the British Library, available everywhere to some extent. There are tweet buttons, there are posts on Wikipedia buttons, there are posts on Facebook buttons. And we're also working with various sort of tech startups to come up with apps and also interesting projects and products which build on these resources and do things with them. People like History Pin, which is a tool for serving up photographs of the place you are on your iPhone. But we've had a few what we've called hackathons where there's a prize of some development money for people to come up with interesting things to do with these projects. And then I suppose the final project is longevity. Europeana is dependent on European Union money. So that central search resource and indeed the team behind it are reliant on that ongoing in the future. But I suppose it's a distributed collection, and that's one of the good things about it. The collection is distributed amongst these national libraries in the BNF de France, the Danish National Library and so on, Belgian Royal Library, British Library. So hopefully it should be there, and we've worked on standards to enable them to remain there for a very long time indeed. Now, there's one more thing I was going to say about awareness. It may come back to me, it may not. No, it doesn't. Okay. So, what's next? So, memory is a tricky thing. Yeah, what can we do with this corpus? Well, we have, as I said, these dissemination events. It has come back to me. Wikipedia. We've worked with people, the volunteers of Wikipedia, to do things called wiki editathons. This is when we basically buy some pizza, some coffee, give people a room in the library, send a curator along, and invite people who want to come and edit entries in Wikipedia. They've been very popular. They've got some certain amount of press, and they've really improved those Wikipedia entries, which is great. It's done two good things as well. It's taught the curators about the value of Wikipedia, and then on the back of that, we've had an awful lot of traffic. And we've also got in touch and been in contact with all sorts of non-traditional researchers, battlefield tour guides, people with a specialist interest but not necessarily attached to a research institution, people interested in family history, and they've been able to tell us what they want in the tools we're building. And these are groups which is very hard for us as a research academic institution to normally meet. We can meet academics and we can meet other librarians, but the people we're really trying to meet and reach and use these to use these tools, they're much harder to really speak to. So that's one of the great things about Wikipedia events. We also want to do things with teachers. Teachers we think are key. And one of the things the library is doing as part of Europeana Collections 1914-1918 is building a learning website, a sort of an exhibition arranged around themes from the home front through to animals at war, through to why the war began, with documents selected from Europeana, the highlights of the collections, and translated into various different languages, and to really reflect the entire European experience of the war, along with input from teachers from across Europe, so that these resources are suitable for their national curriculum. But that's going to be one key way, I think, of speaking to teachers and school kids. What else could we do with these collections once 3 years are up and 2014 is upon us? Well, we could obviously increase the size of the collections, add more things to them, and we hope we will do that as we continue to digitise things just in a sort of business as usual way. But we could also do other things. There are various aggregation, to use that sort of slightly technical term, aggregation projects around the world. There's the Digital Public Library of America being built and mooted at the moment, sort of started in Harvard, but is now an independent organization. And the idea of these digital aggregators, these digital libraries, is not that they will necessarily have a copy in their servers of everything, but they are a one-stop shop, a sort of a they have the catalogue record, and much as I showed, jumping from that search through to the British Library servers or the Bibliothèque Nationale servers, you'll be able to do that perhaps with some of this connection if we find resources of interest to America or the United States and Canada. And there are national ones as well. In the United Kingdom, there's an idea to, or there's a project to bring together as many digital resources in one place as well, so we can feed into that. And if anybody, any of you have any projects that we could link to, that would be great. And then there's also things we can do with this data set. And I'm sort of coming towards the end now, you might be pleased to know. But so there are things we can do with this material. As I mentioned Smiley, or Smiler, that chap who's recuperating in Brighton. We don't know much about him. We don't have time or the resources to do much about him. But you might know something about him. He may be your relative or you know about him. So you should be able to perhaps add data to that. So the crowdsourcing aspect could well be the next step. And I know the National Library of Australia and the National Archives there are sort of leaders in that technology. The OCR that I mentioned will allow us to do things such as search right across all our trench newspapers at once, looking for whatever it is you're looking for. I don't know, accounts of people who work with animals or pigeons or something like that. Natural language processing is something we can apply to it, a sort of digital humanities methodology, so that the search tool knows names of people, of places, of events. So you can do a search across this data set and say, tell me everybody's responses to this battle, perhaps if they, I don't know, some other criteria that relates to them as well, or their age, their gender, their occupation, and so on. Because you can link perhaps to other data sets as well, which would be of great interest. And I know the Imperial War Museum is experimenting with some of that technology to enable you to search across census records and battlefield records and family history sites. And then this vast data set also is open to all sorts of data mining techniques. You may not necessarily be interested in the First World War, but you might be really interested in language, how language changed. How did language change over this period? How often are words like dislocation and trauma used? When does tragedy begin to be used as a way of describing and talking about the war? Is tragedy used more in America, or is it used more in Britain? That's just one thing I've noticed. We tend to talk about the tragedy of the First World War, but here I've picked up more it's a catastrophe and a disaster. And then you could test that thesis by data mining this data set. Okay, I'm 30 seconds over time. These are the websites, but I would just Google Europeana and then First World War or World War I and you'll get there. Europeana has a hashtag as well as lots of Twitter accounts if you're interested in those. There's mine if you're interested. So that's it, and I'll just leave with Smiler, who was lurking behind the scenes all along.
Next up will be Mr. Brian Grubbs.
Good good afternoon. I'm very pleased to be here along with my fellow panelists, and we're very excited and honored to be speaking with you today. I think today's session is particularly well-timed as a follow-up to our previous session where we were talking about the application of technology to engage younger audiences. Missouri in the Great War is a statewide collaborative digitization project that sets out to document Missouri's role both at home and abroad during World War I. The origins of this project actually stemmed from work that was done to document the Civil War in Missouri. In 2007, the Springfield-Greene County Library District, where I'm based, launched a digitization project to document the impact of the Civil War in the Ozarks. 21 organizations from across the country contributed over 11,000 pages of primary source material to place online for free access. We developed a virtual museum which you can spin artifacts 360 degrees and used HTML5 to develop an interactive timeline allowing researchers to explore over 130 events that transpired specifically in the Midwest. This work then became the basis of several other Civil War projects as organizations in St. Louis, Kansas City, Columbia, and Cape Girardeau then formed partnerships in their area to explore the Civil War in their region. As our efforts in the Civil War history came to a conclusion, our organization started to discuss what efforts we could put together and combining our resources and expertise to develop a single digital collection for Missouri in World War I. Our goal was then to document through various manuscripts, photographs, artifacts, and other media in preparation for the Centennial Remembrance. Missouri actually has a really interesting history with World War I. Missourians actively contributed to various aspects of the war effort before America joined the hostilities. Missouri industries filled mules and munitions contracts and other goods for Allied armies. These existing networks then were used to supply American expeditionary forces beginning in 1917. According to the Missouri State Archives, 156,000 Missourians served in the war. Some authorities rank Missouri 8th in total number of men in uniform. Prominent Missourians include Generals John J. Pershing and Enoch Crowder, future President Harry S. Truman, and Walt Disney. And the last surviving U.S. veteran, Frank Buckles, was also a Missouri native. So through the perspective of these Missourians and the lens of Missouri, we'll be exploring the complex histories of the war, discussing topics like the experience of Missouri troops in combat and support roles, civilian support efforts here on the home front, medical advancements. So I don't know if the gentleman who's in the crowd that wanted to talk about medicine in the last session's here, but it's not completely overlooked. We'll be talking about propaganda, the application of new technology to warfare, and on and on and on. To accomplish this task, we set up partnerships with organizations across the state. We've hired project staff positioned in multiple locations here, one at the National World War I Museum. These staff have reviewed over 140 Missouri-related collections, which equals out to be over 34,000 pages of manuscript material. Project staff also developed a blog and Facebook page to inform our target audience about project progress and interesting pieces of World War I history. Our blog and Facebook posts regularly feature interesting collections that staff have found, profiles of individuals or organizations that the staff have visited. These social media tools serve multiple purposes, but I think most importantly, they provide a platform for patron-driven feedback and discussion, and they also allow us to identify private collections. So not only are we working to digitize material in museums and archives across Missouri, but we're also working to bring in the privately held material and things that have been passed down from generation to generation. The blog's URL, missouriovertheredot.org, will serve as the address for the digital collection once the site goes live. Thus, we're building an active user base that has already accustomed to visiting the site before the collection goes live. So not only have we been working to find the material, but we've also been working to develop how we're going to be presenting this material to the collections. So this will be an overview of our homepage. It's not quite exactly how it's going to look. There'll be some more color and a few more pictures, but you get the general idea. So the collections will be browsable by two very broad categories, whether it's a civilian aspect or the military aspect. So by clicking on one of those, you'll then be able to drill down to more specific information. and it will have very specific themes under each area. So if you want to know more about civilian support organizations, you can click on that link, which will then take you to some narrative and thumbnails of artifacts, the media, the documents, the photographs, whatever relates to that topic. This tiered structure thus allows researchers to determine their own level of learning. So if they want to look at the big picture, they can do that, or if they want to drill down to more specific information, that's also available to them. On the military side, we're going to have the same approach, but we're also going to be looking at the overseas aspect in addition to the training and stateside perspective. It's a very similar situation where each of those links will then take you to a collection overview page where you can find out very specific information about that collection and how it fits within the general framework of the war. Now, the narrative that we're going to be developing is not the definitive history on a given topic, but just designed to provide a context for researchers to understand what's being discussed in the primary source material. And same thing with the state side, where we'll be talking about the influenza outbreak and the punitive expedition on the Mexican border. One of the cool pieces that we're really working to put together is a soldier database and virtual service record. So here you'll be able to put in specific search criteria, branch of service, their name, and it'll pull up a listing of all the Missouri soldiers that meet that parameters. So if you click on an individual's name, it'll then take you to their virtual service record, where you'll find their basic service information, a photograph, and then also an opportunity where you'll have actual scans of the documents related to that. We'll be pulling these fantastic genealogical research together from a wide variety of organizations. The State Historical Society of Missouri has a fantastic obituary collection for Missouri World War I soldiers, and the State Archives and the Missouri History Museum actually have this fantastic biographical sketches completed by the soldiers after they returned home. And so we'll be digitizing these types of records for the first time and putting them together in one database. Now, what this platform is also going to allow us to do is provide a way for the patrons to also contribute material. So if we don't have a photograph for this individual or we don't have an obituary, there will be a link on this database where you can actually upload material to the site. This also gives our patrons a sense of ownership to the project and a reason for them to keep coming back. And then with the soldier database side, if you click on the division, it'll take you to a divisional history. And then you'll have two links from there, where you can browse the collections on the other side of all the material that we have digitized related to the 35th Division. Or you can then go and repopulate a list of the regimental or the divisional roster and have an alphabetical listing of everyone in that division. So again, this will be a fantastic genealogical tool for anyone interested in Missouri veterans. So as you can see, this project has a lot of work to do yet. We're still in our planning phase. This project is funded by an Institute for Museum and Library Services grant from the Missouri State Library. And our partners expand pretty vast within the state, but we're also looking to develop partnerships outside of Missouri and develop national partnerships and even international partnerships of any material that relates to a Missouri soldier or civilian. We envision this being a multi-year project where we're continually adding new collections, developing new partnerships, and adding interactive components to the site. We've applied for a grant to implement our plan, and we hope to learn about that here shortly. This would allow us to digitize roughly 35 collections and put about 5,000 pages of material online. We'll also then be able to start launching our website, and we hope to have it active by the end of 2014. So we're very excited about the potential that this project holds. The Civil War project, which I briefly mentioned earlier, has had great success. Over 2,500 researchers access that website each month. As a result, our partners have also seen an increased use of their collections. For example, Wilson's Creek National Battlefield has seen a 150% increase in research requests and image reproduction requests since putting their material online. And we fully anticipate that this trend will carry forward with the World War I project. So if you have any questions or would like to talk with me more about the project, here's my contact information. I'd also be happy to speak with you after today's session. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Houlihan, what some of our international audience members might not know is that on July 12, 1973, there was actually a fairly disastrous fire in St. Louis. It's on the other side of the state, which destroyed about 80% of the National Archive record of Army personnel discharged from World War I. So the work that they're doing with this project, collecting from all these other sources, is really going to be a boon for our state, and hopefully as a model for others. Dr. Patrick Houlihan, thank you very much. I invite you to the podium.
Thank you, Laura, and thanks to the museum for hosting this event. I'm going to be speaking to you today, giving you a preview of these articles. They're related to my book project from being published at Cambridge, as Laura said. But the articles today are on the churches and religious mobilization and popular belief. Two articles for the collection 1914 to 1918 online, which aims to be a highly visible and international collaboration of accessible scholarship. So I'll be giving an overview of that today. And I want to begin here in the heartland of Kansas, in Kansas City, in the heartland of America. I thought it appropriate to begin with something from William James, the American pragmatist philosopher. James' famous text, The Varieties of Religious Experience, from 1901 to 1902, his famous Gifford Lectures at the University of Edinburgh. And it's important here to stress varieties of what we're talking about. Because overall, the religious history of religion in the war occupies an unjustly marginalized position in the cultural history of World War I. Now, partially, I would attribute this to a grand narrative of European secularization in the post-Enlightenment period. But more in the 20th century, what we're dealing with here is, Madras Eckstein's famously put it, the emergence of orgiastic nihilistic irony as a trope that encapsulates the cultural history of the war. Fantastic book, by the way. But what James is talking about is a plurality of religious experience that I think is quite essential. And it was early 20th century that he broached these topics, of course. But later scholars, more recently, have stressed some of these fundamental theoretical conclusions as well. And I just want to give you two that have influenced my work as well. Charles Taylor's A Secular Age is a very dense, learned tome published recently. And what Taylor is doing there, I like to stress, is, quote, understand better belief and unbelief as lived conditions, not just as theories or sets of beliefs subscribed to, unquote. So if you want to check out a little bit more on current secularization, look at Charles Taylor. More historically oriented, though, is Brad S. Gregory's The Unintended Reformation. Really fantastic example. Gregory is a Reformation historian, but don't let that dissuade you. The work is highly relevant to the 21st century. Indeed, Gregory frames talking about modern era in, quote, a hyper-pluralism of religious and secular commitments, not any shared or even convergent view about what we think is true or right or good, marks the early 21st century. So we'll use that as a starting point. And then what does this have to do with religion in the First World War? Well, we're at a transnational moment in the historiography of the First World War. Here previously in Kansas City, Jay Winter and Hugh Strawn, among others, have realized that we're going into this transnational generation now, following, you know, previous waves of political, social, and cultural history. And yet, national historiographies of religion still predominate. This is despite the pioneering work of Annette Becker and others, and War and Faith is really a breakthrough book in the cultural history of religion. But national historiographies are deeply entrenched. What I'm arguing here is that transnational history, in particular, is a way of illuminating these varieties of the religious experience. And that happens, I'm arguing, in two ways. Number one, it incorporates an institutional as well as individual experience of religion. And number two, and well, I should say, I should also point out, this parallels very nicely with my articles that I'm writing, one on the churches as such will capture the more institutional realm, and the other on the individual realm will capture the more religious and popular belief aspects. But what transnational history in general seeks to illuminate is processes, historical processes, both above and below, but also including the level of the nation. And we should not discount, the nation is incredibly important as a focus of collective sacrifice. And it's certainly religious histories of the war have to take that into account. But it is not the only story at play. So in as much time as I have available, I'd like to sketch a little of how these play out and what I'm doing for my articles and future research. Institutional religion is largely characterized by the top-down pronouncements of elites in the public sphere, especially along this notion of a holy war, a just war of defense against aggression, a defense of state interests, with high clerics kind of full furiously identifying with the cause of state. In Germany, the famous Gott mit uns, or infamous Gott mit uns. In France, the Union Sacrée, the reuniting of left and right in successful defense of the nation. And more perhaps inflammatory in terms of Middle Eastern history, of course, the notion of jihad. David Fromkin's Peace to End All Peace is perhaps a good starting point in studying the history of that region during the war. But let me give you one of the most infamous pronouncements was by Arthur Winnington Ingram, the Bishop of Anglican Bishop of London. And in 1915, Winnington Ingram announced to his congregation, quote, "We are banded in a great crusade. We cannot deny it, to kill Germans. To kill them not for the sake of killing, but to save the world. To kill the good as well as the bad, to kill the young men as well as the old, to kill those who have shown kindness to our wounded, as well as those fiends who crucified the Canadian sergeant, who supervised the Armenian massacres, who sank the Lusitania, and who turned the machine guns on the civilians of Aerschot and Louvain, and to kill them lest the civilization of the world should itself be killed," unquote. So how we see that played out visually, in terms of institutional religion. Here is Germany, the Gott mit uns, and here we have the literal altar of the nation. Gott mit uns, this is a field chapel from a Württemberg regiment. You see the Iron Cross here at the bottom. So this is the sanctified holy altar of the nation, Gott mit uns. And God is with us. The phrase in German also carries an exclusionary undertone, that God is not with the other side. This is an example of pre-Vatican II liturgy. This is a field mass being held. I'd like to stress here the separation of, it looks like it's held in a railway station, and the tracks go right through the separation of priest and congregation. And of course, the priest is facing the altar in the pre-Vatican II liturgy away from the congregation. This is perhaps even more pronounced in the next example, which is an Austro-Hungarian field mass in the Italian front. What we have here is the literal separation of priest and congregation. The priest is at an altar in the middle of a lake here. So there's quite literal and figurative separation that's going on, and quite different from, of course, our post-Vatican II conceptions of liturgy. Now let's move on to talking about individual religion. And here I want to address the problem of individual belief as a historical problem of evidence. Annette has raised this in some of her work too, that prayer and belief, these very metaphysical notions, it can be hard to kind of document that and to get at that historically. And there are methodological ways to go about that, but I introduce it as a problem that we definitely need to think through about representation and the kinds of evidence that we're using to support these claims. So Part of how we access that are, of course, the traces that remain through the devotional objects, a bric-a-brac, a collection of, you know, amulets, devotional pictures, traces of prayers that way, but also, of course, standard historical sources, you know, memoirs, diaries, letters, and especially local evidence, local familial evidence that is often not found in standard religious histories of the war. So this will also bring us into talking about notions of superstition and magic and a personalized sense of belief and forms of belief that perhaps differed outside of the standard dogmas but form part of a wide spectrum of religious belief, absolutely essential to how people understood what was happening to them. And some examples of that are, here's an example of devotion in the trenches. This is an altar on the Western Front. The men have hollowed out a shrine, and it's for the Sacred Heart of Jesus, Catholic subcult. And here's another example of individualized devotion to the standing mother grieving, of course, a standard trope in Catholic artistic representations of the war, the Pietà, of course. The element of Christian sacrifice that Annette Becker has mentioned yesterday as well. But I like this picture to incorporating women and children and generations of women and children, often forgotten in religious histories of the war that stress high elite clerics and those prominent in the public sphere, but absolutely essential to understanding processes of memory and mourning that went on for individuals and families. So where does this leave us? In bringing this to an end, we can see the nation mattered, but of course it wasn't the only locus of sacrifice. And an essential part of clarifying this will be clarifying the avenues at stake in far as inspiring loyalties and inspiring disloyalties, that spectrum of belief and unbelief as well. Some ways of getting above this are in just quickly outlining here. You know, Catholicism, of course, is a transnational example par excellence that's been theorized, but in many ways, the Catholic story with modernity begins in Vatican II. So this is, you know, how do we get to that point, a Catholic modernity that takes account of the era of the world wars and really fleshes that out. Of course, Islam, and the we've spoken a little bit about this earlier, but absolutely essential for understanding the complicated political histories of the region, as well as informing some aspects of the Armenian genocide as well. But also, missionary movements are key to understanding this, and particularly, you know, Protestant evangelicalism that begins in a kind of global, muscular Christianity, especially in the Anglo-American sphere, but is really a global, transnational process with still, you know, worldwide relevance to this day, and experienced very sudden shifts during the First World War. We also need to account for religion as a form of peacemaking as well. Informal and formal networks helped contributed to both not only the famous peace overtures of 1917, but also post-war reconciliation. And there are other aspects of more intellectual transnational history as well, perhaps most famously in Protestant circles, Karl Barth's dialectical theology, and others related to it, but a return to kind of neo-orthodoxy and a dialogue between neo-orthodox and more forward-looking forms of Protestant theology as well. But one could also look at Jewish theology in some ways. Martin Buber, the famous I-Thou dialogues are very much informed by Buber's perspectives, seeing refugees from Galicia and the Eastern Front in World War I. So a vast theological a wave, a renaissance is happening as a result of the First World War, and we need to take this into account as well. But there, we should also look below the level of the nation as well to incorporate local and regional histories, especially for regions like Tyrol, sitting on the border, cannot categorize it easily in national terms. but other aspects, the familial that I hinted at as well, with bringing the story of women and children into the religious history of the First World War. Annette Becker has done some of that for Catholic France, and others have for other nations. But really making that more of a European and indeed global process is a foremost criteria for future research. And really, as much as we can, getting in that individual notion of personalized belief. Of course, we're reaching after an unattainable limit, a fundamental problem of subjectivity, but as closer we can get to respecting that as individual historical actors, we need to try to do that. So in summation, I'll leave with this final slide, which is a inauguration day in the Weimar Republic in Germany. And this is the day of the National Assembly, which was inaugurated on February the 6th, 1919. And I want to focus attention on a couple of things here. I don't know how well you can see it. But one of the things to point out, this is a Catholic church. This is in the state of Württemberg. And you'll notice that every single space in the pew is filled with believers attending the opening service. Now, they are having some kind of a prayer mass, you know, saying beliefs for the newly inaugurated Weimar Republic. And, you know, this is in contrast to, you know, current popular reports about the secularization of Europe, of course, and the empty churches, which are, you know, certainly valid in some areas and must be taken into account. But to take a step backward here, to get back into the day, there are counter statistics, as we would say, and those need to be taken into account too in talking about a European experience of religion. I think the Capital Cities Project from Cambridge has already done a little bit of this as well, talking about London, Paris, and Berlin as foremost sites of modernism that already experienced immense amount of religious vitality during the war, even at these, you know, preeminent modern sites of urbanity. And one needs to talk about that as well for other regions of Europe. And I specifically highlight this to focus on the notion of crisis. And the famous German historian Detlef Peukert called the Weimar Republic the crisis of classical modernity. So crisis being both a sense of danger, but also of opportunity, right? Danger in the sense, of course, this is leading to the Nazi period, and we cannot escape the fundamental religiously motivated anti-Semitism culminating, of course, in the destruction of the Holocaust. But it is an essential part of a religious memory of the First World War. So certainly the sense of danger, but also as opportunity, and an opportunity for revitalization of certain religious groups in some ways, and going back to kind of what points that Jay Winter has emphasized earlier, memory and mourning, allowing people a sense of comfort and to come to terms with the destruction that happened in the war. The religious memories in this case should not be discounted as well. So this multiplicity of meaning in the form of crisis, I want to leave you with that notion, and we can think about that. But I hope this pluralism that I'll continue to talk about in my work, and as others will as well, this pluralism will encompass both belief and unbelief, illuminating a wide spectrum, and that hopefully this type of work will kind of recapture the varieties of religious experience that hopefully would have satisfied William James. Thank you very much.
Patrick, thank you very much. Being able to experience the robust scholarship that is being made available, open access, without charge, using international scholars like yourself is fantastic. Thank you. We are opening up to a time for question and answer. Again, that this is a panel for digital commemoration. We actually are going to start with some questions from Facebook. I think a lot of you represent institutions, academia, government, all that seem to be reaching out via social media, Facebook, Twitter. So we'll start with a couple of those. The first actually is from Jason Heck. I would like to ask if there's a large-scale effort that will be made to get archive materials digitally transcribed and made available to the public.
I will answer that question for you. Jason, thank you for watching this video. The answer is yes, and I'm glad to introduce you to the gentlemen who are, in fact, doing that. Would you all like to say anything more about that question besides a rousing yes?
I'd just like to add a bit of a no. In terms from a European's point of view, we'll be OCRing the printed material. There are methods and ways of transcribing autograph handwritten material. Transcribe Bentham is one sort of well-known project, and there are lots of Civil War ones as well. But that's not part of our project. Maybe the next steps, maybe part of the learning site, but we'd like to do more of that.
To counter that a little bit, the work that we're doing on the Missouri project will be transcribed and made fully keyword searchable, which comes with an added expense in time and hours.
The second question actually comes from Steve Jernigan. How do you feel the digital media of commemoration personalizes or depersonalizes the commemoration itself? I can ask that again. How do you feel that the digital medium personalizes or depersonalizes commemoration?
I suppose there's something about digital media which is, and just the internet, depersonalizes the experience to some extent. You're not holding that object in your hands. But the things like the collection days means that you do experience those things, and you meet other people as well, and it becomes a community event as much as an individual thing mediated through the internet. And I think a few years ago, perhaps reading online was quite tricky, but increasingly it's become more the norm and is more transparent, and people get used to it, and will change over time as well.
And I think the internet and digital resources actually increases longevity of commemoration. We had the discussion in the last session about, do you look for a five-year commemoration? Do we have one event, or do we have a series event? How do we sustain those? Well, with the online technology and web applications, you can have one event or a series event, but then the users then can go home and explore the content, the collections of material on their own pace and their own level of learning.
And if I could just jump in on that, as far as creating a community of scholarship, of course, the digital era provides an incredible opportunity. Of course, the Republic of Letters is much older than the digital age, but it's gotten a lot easier to work across international boundaries, to contact scholars, to facilitate projects. I mean, the Capital Cities project that I referred to, the Cambridge volumes, that are resulting in both increased traditional print media as well as increasingly visible international digital online collaborations, like the 1914 to 1918 project, like Europeana. The digital age has fostered that kind of collaboration immensely, and I think will continue at that pace in the future.
Thank you. I'd like to open up to questions in the audience. It would be better if Andrea can come to you with a microphone, or if you can come down to the microphone down here. Thank you.
The first two speakers mentioned as part of their projects the opportunity for just ordinary viewers or users of your platforms to, through crowdsourcing or sort of in wiki fashion, to add some of their own material. And as somebody who's read some Wikipedia pages that are outrageous, one, for instance, which described Louisiana as Jesus Christ's sugar shack, which then was corrected within an hour. But I wonder if you could speak to your experiences with the advantages and maybe some of the perils of opening up the platform to sort of to the general users in that fashion.
Okay. I'll speak quickly to that. I suppose the main project, which is open to general users, is Europeana 1914 to 1918. There is an editorial process. There are cataloging standards which are applied. So it's kind of the middle way, I suppose. And there's a long debate about Wikipedia, how useful is it, how reliable it is, and so on, which I'm not going to get into, apart from to say I have been hugely impressed and amazed by how much comes out of these editathons and meeting wiki editors and the real quality that can be brought to, I know entries on Louisiana once people who know a lot of, about these subjects get together with, and have access to resources in libraries and elsewhere.
And for us, we're really looking towards just more the content, not really the contextualization. So the photographs, the documents, those things, then we'll use our staff and our expertise to actually provide the contextualization for those materials.
I think that's part of the exciting thing about all the projects that you all represent, representing those that have editors and those that are encouraging the broad public to get involved with your Wikipedia-a-thons. Is that what they were called?
Wikiathons.
Wikiathons, thank you. I think we'll take the question over here next.
So many questions, so little time. You spoke earlier about the common criteria. Which level of CC licensing are you using with your piano?
Very slightly from project to project. The ideal is something Creative Commons Zero. And that our metadata is all Creative Commons Zero. That's part of the European data model framework we've signed up to. Everything else will be under a range of licenses from open government licenses through to CC, BY, CC, various kind. The ideal is as freely available as possible. We also put non-commercial on it as well. That's perhaps the
and the other
most, most common one.
Was, would you be doing any type of digital watermarking or any type of DRM within the what would be offered?
Yeah, no DRM in the sense of locking down the software, no digital watermarking, just very good as good metadata as we can get into the image file and licensing around it. We want to be able to, well, because Creative Commons, I guess we know what it is, but it, most people perhaps don't. So we need to make it as easy to understand as possible, whilst also respecting the rights of those who hold the copyrights initially.
We'll have time for only one or two more questions. Go ahead.
Thank you. I'm Nigel Dacre from London. My company produces a range of websites, including one about the centenary called centenarynews.com, just to get the plug in. But we're putting a lot of thought into how digitally to engage with people about the centenary and the centennial. And I kind of think my question to you is, how are you going to future-proof what you're doing? If you can just imagine, okay, we're now talking about 6 years, aren't we, when you're talking about the sort of the period of the whole centenary going forward. Imagine what's happened over the past 6 years on the digital front. A lot of things we're talking about, we wouldn't have been able to do kind of 6 years ago. So I think, how are you thinking about future-proofing it? What sort of areas? I mean, the obvious ones, everything's going to become a lot more mobile. People are going to do things in a far more social network orientated way rather than going to destination websites. That's what always worries me about just creating a kind of destination site like the Europeana one. So just some thoughts about the future, really.
Well, I'll quickly respond to that and then pass on to the others. Yeah, I know what you mean about destination sites, and Europeana is very much about being Europeana everywhere in that it's very easy to embed it elsewhere and get the data out and put it in your own site, obviously with referring to Europeana, link backs and so on. The learning site is going to be mobile first to some extent, so it will be scalable. There's going to be video within that. But the real thing about future-proofing for our collection is this: the idea of the standards, the metadata. So the shell that it's in, the nice graphics are fine, and the interpretation layers are there, but it's the core of the stuff, the images and the metadata and the links between them can be ported from generation to generation. We hope that's the aim anyway.
Ditto.
All right, I think there is one more question. Dr. Beaumont.
Yes, thanks very much. I was going to ask you and perhaps other members in the audience what is happening in the area of, I suppose, digitising the landscape. I mean, one of the issues that Australian commemoration always faces is that we've always fought in other people's countries, and usually enemy countries, and we have had a lot of difficulties politically in superimposing our heritage and commemorative practices on other people's sovereign soil. The Turkish government was unkind enough to point out to our government once that Anzac Cove actually was Turkish. and it seems to me, having done a lot of work on the Thai-Burma Railway, where there are in fact cultural inhibitions about respecting and acknowledging publicly sites of mass death and trauma, that one of the big solutions of the future is actually to record the landscape digitally and with apps, and I know people are doing this already, with apps enabling people to make their own pilgrimages and their own tours. And this question may come up in the World Heritage Session tomorrow, but it seems to me that the future really resides in independent memory touring. And that what one can do, if you take again the Thai-Burma Railway, so much of what actually is important in terms of the narrative has gone into the jungle. But if you can identify it with GPS referencing and then convert it into augmented reality or something like this, then I think you've got an enormous potential for memory, which goes well beyond the objects, because now that we're past the veterans, we're into the point where the landscape is a witness to what happened in many instances. So I'm just wondering what's happening in terms of World War I landscape mapping digitally.
And that's a fascinating question. I know English Heritage are doing a lot of work on those areas, but that's obviously British sites and naval sites of sunken ships and so on. And there are all sorts of interesting things to do about physically mapping the landscape. We have a lot of maps and we have a lot of technology that enables us to sort of warp them and place them on top of Google Earth and so on. But in our metadata standards, we're very keen to try and geographically locate our objects, which enables us, as the last question said, to sort of future-proof it and have people to, you know, stand somewhere in Belgium and say, what are the photographs or letters and diaries of things that took place near here? Some things work better than others because the information just isn't that precise, but it's moving in that direction, and I think that will be probably the next step in terms of how these things are interfaced, and certainly geographical interfaces are going to be key in the learning site anyway.
And unfortunately, I am going to go ahead and stop us here. It's a fantastic question that I hope continues as the day and the weekend and the conference continues, that question gets discussed outside of our time slot. Unfortunately, our time is up. I do want to thank Brian Grubbs, Matthew Shaw, Patrick Houlihan for discussing and sharing the scholarship that is going to be available and the underpinnings behind that and the workings that are taking place to make that scholarship and those artifacts available to an international public. Thank you all very much for your time. Thank you all for joining us.